had the chance to sit down with Feridun Sinirlioglu for an exclusive interview. I started by asking him how Turkey's strikes against the YPG, the Kurdish fighters, fit in his country's strategy.
The whole thing started 4 and a half years ago. We thought that this will be, if it lasts too long, this country will turn into a safe haven of terrorists. And this is what's happening. And fighting a terror group doesn't make a terror group a legitimate group.
You know, you're saying Kurds are terrorists.
Nusra is also fighting Daesh, but that doesn't make them a legitimate group, as we all say. And these are not Kurds per se. I mean, the Kurds in Syria, in the northern Syria, are under the oppression of that group. And this is all very well actually depicted in the report of the Amnesty International.
So you believe this makes the YPG, those fighters in the northern part of Syria, who have registered some victories against ISIS, legitimate targets by the Turkish military?
So did al-Nusra. Did al-Nusra. Al-Nusra also registered a lot of victories over ISIS, but they are still a terror organization.
So that makes them legitimate targets, you believe?
No, we are not targeting them in Tel Abyad yet. If they do not, we have set three conditions, actually. We said if they do not cross to the west of Euphrates, if they do not target Turkey, or if they do not attack Turkey, we will not target them. But if they do that, then they are our legitimate
target. And it appears as though that's what happened. They tried to cross west of the Euphrates,
yes,
and there was a targeting
they
operation.
Did try to cross to the west of Euphrates, and then we targeted them.
So what?
But it happened once, and they didn't try again.
Russia has really entered over the last, I believe now it's been a little more than a month that they started bombing in Syria. They've authorized the bombing in Iraq. That hasn't happened yet. Why do you think Russia has entered this war now? What do you make of the timing?
That question should be asked to them, of course. I don't want to answer that question on their behalf. But for us, this was a mistake, and we told them so. I mean, we told them that what they are doing is a big mistake. They are becoming part of a civil war, which is not to their interest, which is not to the interest of Syria, which is not to the interest of the region as a whole. I don't see any reason for Russia being involved directly.
They're supporting the regime.
They do
the
support
president.
The regime, yes. But I mean, regime is just a part of the civil war.
Yeah, but are they not in a way shaping events a lot more than the U.S. has and has tried a few training of rebels, but that kind of didn't amount to anything? And Russia is very clearly engaging itself in a conflict where it's having an impact. Like it or not, it's doing that inside Syria.
You know, United States is our ally and friend. We have been working on many issues together, including Syria. Of course, they can do more, and this is what we have been telling them all along. For instance, we have been advocating the establishment of a no-fly zone and a humanitarian safe zone. I think they were not ready to go along with those suggestions. But I think they were able to do more, and we are continuing to ask them to do more.
Do you think the country will remain one?
The main obstacle in front of the unity is Assad. What Assad now is trying is actually carving out a mini-state out of the existing Syria. This is what we can see on the ground, what he is doing. Mm-hmm. You know, in July, when he said that I can no longer extend my authority or my defense lines all over the country, he, in a way, confessed that he is going for a plan B. That's what we
so
understand.
So you think the territorial integrity of the country is very much at risk, it sounds like.
It is, because of Assad.
You speak of democracy and of freedom, and there are critics, I don't have to tell you this, of the current Turkish government, the government you're the cabinet minister of right now, who are very unhappy with the jailing of some journalists. There's one in particular, Mohammed Rasul of Vice. He's been in prison 2 months. Ahmed Hakan, beaten, intimidated. Some journalists are saying we can't keep track of how many people are being sued for, quote, insulting the president. What is going on in Turkey with regards to press freedom?
All these issues are openly debated in Turkey. There is nothing hidden, and nobody is in prison because of what he is writing or because of journalistic activities. The people who are in jail, what you mentioned now, has some connection to the terror groups. And you know, public order comes first.
Even Ahmed Hakan, who's one of the most
respected journalists? Ahmed Hakan was beaten by some people, and there is already a police investigation going on. And there is a court case against that.
Okay. And Mohammed Rasul Vice is very unhappy. They're saying he's a 25-year-old who was a fixer, who was assisting two British journalists. He's been in prison 2 months. Are any of these situations of journalists being imprisoned, are any of the critics right to be concerned, do you think?
Of course there are concerns, and people are talking about it. But I'm telling you, there are clear evidence that the guy you are mentioning has direct connection to the terror group, which is responsible for a lot of terror activities in Turkey.